Good morning. Thank you for joining us this Sunday morning at Colonial Hill Baptist Church. I'm Ernie Armstrong, and it's my privilege to lead in Bible study this morning from Colonial Hill. Today's lesson is going to be taken from chapter 9 of Ecclesiastes out of the Old Testament. You may recall, if you have been with us through these this quarter of lessons, that a little over a month ago, Suddenlink had a problem one Sunday, and we ended up recording an extra lesson, or a lesson that could not be presented on the cable TV for that Sunday. And so we had an extra lesson. In order to finish this quarter's lessons, the last Sunday in August, it means we either run over to the next quarter, which I do not think is a good idea, and we eliminate one of the remaining lessons. Today's lesson, I had three lessons to choose two from when we finally made that decision, and I chose to present the lesson from chapter 9 rather than the lesson from chapter 7, primarily because I never could understand chapter 7. And so I decided to not present that lesson and instead present today's lesson from chapter 9, which should catch us up, by the way, and get us, for those of you who listen and watch with us, and then also go to a Sunday school class to study these same materials. While chapter 7, in my opinion, was extremely difficult to understand, chapter 9 is somewhat depressing. Chapter 9 considers, from Solomon's point of view, that death is inevitable. Now, that's absolutely true. But some of his thoughts and conclusions, I don't believe, fit very well in our New Testament mindset. But let's look at that in a bit and see what we can glean from Solomon's wisdom. Remember, the author of this book is believed to be Solomon. Some translations use the title. Let me pause. The author does not say this is written by Solomon. He refers to himself as the son of the king of Israel in Jerusalem. That's Solomon. No other king was the son of David and sitting on the throne in Jerusalem. There were others who sat on the throne, but they were not sons of David. But he doesn't use that term, Solomon, or his name, Solomon. He uses a term that could be translated preacher or teacher. And I have, as some of the scholars that I study from have done, I go back and forth between preacher and teacher when referring to the author. A summary of a one-sentence summary of Ecclesiastes chapter 9 might say, in light of death, which is inevitable, live life and make the best of a bad thing. That sounds very fatalistic, as does most of the chapter. So let's look at that and see where we're coming from, and maybe point out what we today might think of as flaws in Solomon's thinking. I'm reading from the New International Version for those of you who wish to read along with me. And let's read verse 1. So I reflected on all this and concluded that the righteous and the wise and what they do are in God's hands. But no one knows whether love or hate awaits them. So, the wise are in the hand of God, as well as, the righteous and the wise are in the hand of God, but they don't know what's coming to them. With the author's idea about under the sun, his under the sun premise, that is, we live this life, and anytime he talks about under the sun, he's talking about this life on earth. He also uses the expression under the heavens. It basically means the same thing. He's talking about the life we live often without any regard for heaven or for God. And with that premise, there is no real sense of eternity or accountability in a afterlife, a life to come. Man can neither know, he can neither know love or hatred just by what he sees in front of him. He can't see what's coming ahead. Creation can tell us that God exists, but it doesn't tell us very much that God loves us. I'm talking creation doesn't. We only have to look around to see that there is a God. The 19th Psalm 19 and also Romans chapter 1 verses 19 and following tell us that there is a powerful and glorious creator by pointing to creation. But it takes more than an observation to discover how he is disposed towards us. Seeing beyond this, life is just life here on earth without any sense of an afterlife, we can say that we should not measure God's love by what happens to us. We measure instead God's love by Jesus on the cross. That tells us all there is to know about God's love. The teacher, Solomon, has once again allowed his thoughts of God, and he does think of God and acknowledges God's sovereign power. He says, we're in the hand of God, hands of God. But he's developing into a fatalistic thought pattern. He says, we all share in a common destiny. That common destiny is death. That thought process may go something like this. I know God rules over everything. He's sovereign. We're in his hands. But then it goes on to say, it seems that the same thing, nevertheless, happens to all of us. All of us die without real meaning in our lives. And, fatalistically speaking, this powerful, sovereign God wants it to be that way. So, the wise are in the hand of God and don't know what's coming to them. So it doesn't matter who you are. Death is going to come to you as well. It doesn't matter if you live life well or you don't live life well. Death is coming and will be your destiny, says the teacher here, Solomon. And you might not like it. And if you don't like it, you're not by yourself. Solomon, the preacher, the teacher, doesn't like it either. He calls it evil. Verse 2, all share a common destiny. We've been talking about that. The righteous and the wicked, the good and the bad, the clean and the unclean. Those who offer sacrifices and those who do not. As it is with the good, so it is with the sinful. As it is with those who take oath, so those who are afraid to take them. Verse 3, this is the evil. See, he sees this fatalistic destiny as an evil or a bad thing. Everything that happens, this is the evil in everything that happens under the sun. Verse 3, the same destiny overtakes us all. The hearts of people, and here's why he's fatalistic about that. The hearts of people, moreover, are full of evil, and there is madness in their hearts while they live, and afterward they join the dead. You know, there's no life of it, no reference to an afterlife. So he's developing his idea that all of us share the same destiny, and it's meaningless. This life we live is meaningless. At least that's the way it appears, apparently, to Solomon under his under the sun premise. And speaking from his viewpoint, the teacher, that is Solomon, says that all of us have the same fate. But as I mentioned, he does not like it. It's wrong that one event happens to all of us. That one event is death. The fact that all of us die, no matter how you live, is evil in his mind, is bad in his mind. And yet, maybe it's necessary, since the heart of man is evil. He says there in verse, I guess this is verse 3 continuing, the hearts of men are full of evil, and there is madness in their hearts while they live, and afterward they join the dead. That's not good. That's fatalistic, and quite frankly, I think it is depressing. And this seems, and this possibly is one of the reasons that God shortened the life of the lifespan of people after the flood. Remember, there was people living to 900 years of age before the flood. But the longer man is able to live, the more evil he is capable of accomplishing. And that sort of Solomon's perception. And so death ends that evil. But before death, he wants to hold out a little bit of hope that man will turn from evil. Let's see if we can't get a bit of a grasp on that. To all appearances, God just doesn't seem to be interested, at least not to the things that are supposed to be of most interest to him, because they turn out to be of no significance or no difference, or at least none that we can see. We're disposed of in the end in the same way, no matter how we've lived, moral or immoral, religious or profane. We're all mown down just as alike. Everybody is brought to death. And who among us, verse 4, and who among us and who is among the living has hope? Even a live dog is better off than a dead lion. Interesting phraseology. For the living know that, verse 5, that they will die, but the dead know nothing. They have no further reward, and even their name is forgotten. Their love, their hate, and their jealousy have long since vanished. Never again will they will they have a part in anything that happens under the sun. He's talking about death. The living know that they will die. And it's that knowledge that Solomon has continually commented upon throughout this book. The thought of death certainly is unpleasant, but it's crucial. There's hope for one who's living. At least he can consider that death is before him. And in considering that death is before him, he can consider God and his works and have a fear of him. So in light of this inevitable death, the teacher advises you and me to enjoy our life. Let's look at these verses that we just read and briefly talked about. If we have this perspective of Solomon, all of this seems to make sense. If all existence and consciousness ends with death, then the only thing that matters is the present life. Therefore, nothing really matters, says Solomon. It's all meaningless. And he then talks and explains why, because the dead, after you die, you know nothing. There's nothing that they can talk about or do because they are dead. All consciousness and existence ends at death, is the idea that Solomon is putting forth. But we all know that's not true. We have the perspective of having Jesus, who defeated death, who is God's Son, who came to this earth for the sole purpose of being a sacrifice for our sins, saving us from that which we deserve. And then he arose from the grave, defeated death, and promises us an eternity in his presence to those who know and believe in Jesus. Let's look at verses 7 through 10. Go, eat your food. Now, this is Solomon saying, since you're going to die and there's nothing you can do after you die, you might as well enjoy life here. So he picks up with verse 7. Go, eat your food with gladness and drink your wine with a joyful heart, for God has already approved what you do. Always be clothed in white and always anoint your head with oil. Enjoy life with your wife, whom you love, all the days of this meaningless life that God has given you under the sun. All your meaningless days, for this is your lot in life and in your toilsome labor under the sun. Verse 10, whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might, for in the realm of the dead, where you are going, there is neither working nor planning nor knowledge nor wisdom. God approves of you enjoying the life that he gave you, seems to be what Solomon says. He has already approved it. Therefore, don't deny yourself the simple joys that he gives in this life. For instance, if you have a wife, live joyfully with her. Unfortunately, in the line of work that I'm in, I see way, way too many people in our court who are not living joyfully with their spouse. But Solomon would sort of indicate, if you don't have a spouse, if you don't have a wife, men, then find one and then live joyfully with her. Maybe Solomon is being or adding a touch of humor here. He's saying life is utterly meaningless, and our common death and destiny prove it to be so. So forget about everything else I've already said, says Solomon, and instead have a good time. A small hope that you can at least live this meaningless life with some joy and do it the best that you can until you die, because then there's nothing else, says Solomon. God has already approved or accepted your works. Again, Solomon is being fatalistic and perhaps wishing in this statement, I'm hoping there is still some hope while you're alive, because after you're dead, you have no ability to think. So I hope there is something, but if there's not, well, that's just the way it is. Seems to be what Solomon is saying. Live joyfully. Solomon clearly knew that enjoying the good things in his life. Some suggest that was part of his undoing and the undoing of his wisdom. He had 300 wives and 700 concubines. Because I'm very tight with the dollar, or at least supposedly so, and I have a beautiful, wonderful wife who I have been able to enjoy life with. But wives are expensive, guys. To have 300 of them and 700 concubines brings me to challenge Solomon as being a wise person. Anyway, he says in verse 9, wear white garments and anoint your head with oil. The idea is that in a desert land, white reflects the heat of the sun or the rays of the sun, and thus is a little bit cooler garment. And the oil on your head also helps with the coolness. At least that's the idea of some commentators here. So Solomon is saying, make the best of a bad situation. So whatever you can find good to do or pleasurable or enjoyable, do it. Because you're facing death, and after that there is nothing. Verse 10, an interesting verse. Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might, for in the grave where you are going, there is neither working nor planning nor knowledge nor wisdom. That's a verse that's often quoted when someone wants to encourage himself or others to work hard and not be lazy. And we ought to remember the context, however. Ask yourself, what motivates someone to work hard? Well, at least in part, pretty soon you won't be able to work or do anything, says Solomon. So do it now while you have the time. Work, for the night is coming when no one can work anymore. Pause quickly to say, work is something that we as human beings need. Work is often a privilege. God gives us the privilege of being able to work. Now, it is also the means by which we earn a living to take care of all of the needs that we and our families have. But it is a privilege. And those who foster a policy that discourages work, foster a policy that causes problems for mankind. I'm deeply worried that that is the policy that is being enacted in parts of this country, where people are being paid to not work. Work is valuable and important to the esteem of anyone and everyone. And we are wrong to encourage somebody in any manner in which we do it not to work. There is more to work than just labor. There is more to work than just earning the funds with which we can take care of our families work is beneficial to us. And Solomon is saying, that's one thing in verse 10 that you can do, and do it with everything you have. There are some who want to suggest that our present service for God should be done, as stated in verse 10, with all of our might. Spurgeon, the great preacher from the 18th century, "No man ever served God by doing things tomorrow." Spurgeon says, "Man was not created to be idle. He was not elevated to be idle. He was not redeemed to be idle. He was not quickened to be idle. He is not sanctified by God's grace to be idle." To me, that's the same thing I was just saying. There is value to all of us to work. Now, our lesson supposedly ends at verse 10, but it doesn't make sense to me to end it at verse 10. And so we're going to try to get through the rest of the chapter real quickly. Solomon says in verse 11, "I have seen something else under the sun. The race is not to the swift, or the battle to the strong, nor does food come to the wise, or wealth to the brilliant, or favor to the learned, but time and chance happen to them all." What's he saying? Well, sometimes the fastest runner doesn't win the race. Remember the tortoise and the hare. Sometimes the strongest man doesn't win the fight. Sometimes the wisest man doesn't have the most stuff. Why? Because time and chance, from a human perspective, sometimes gets in the way and messes things up. Verse 12, "Moreover, no one knows when their hour will come." He's still talking death. "As fish are caught in a cruel net, or birds are taken in a snare, so people are trapped by evil times that fall unexpectedly upon them." Fish and birds are caught when they don't expect it. Then comes their death. Well, just like them, death comes unexpectedly to us. Except, we all know sometimes death is avoidable, at least for a time. Sometimes, as Solomon has said here, wisdom can preserve the life of the man that possesses it, or the person that possesses it. So the preacher ends chapter 9, the next few verses, with a story about the potential of wisdom to benefit a whole city. We'll see, however, that wisdom still has limitations. In verse 13, he begins telling the story. "I also saw under the sun this example of wisdom that greatly impressed me," he said. "There was once a small city with only a few people in it, and a powerful king came against it, surrounded it, and built huge siege works against it." Get the picture? There's no way this city will stand against this great king. But verse 15. "Now there lived in that city a man, poor but wise, and he saved the city by his wisdom, but nobody remembered that poor man." Great story, but there's a problem with it. Nobody remembered the man who saved the city with his wisdom. And so, there is a problem even with wisdom. And the preacher gives us his conclusion about wisdom. So in verse 16 he says, "So I said, Wisdom is better than strength, but the poor man's wisdom is despised and his words are no longer heeded. So if you compare wisdom to strength, the strength of the great king with the big army sieging the little city, wisdom wins, and yet it is strength that is more valued. It is wisdom that is thought of very little by so many people. They didn't even remember this man who saved them through his wisdom. And then Solomon ends with verses 17 and 18 with two proverbs. Verse 17, the quiet words of the wise man are more to be heeded than the shouts of the ruler of fools. Good proverb. In other words, fools won't listen to wisdom. Verse 18, wisdom is better than weapons of war, but one sinner destroys much good. Wisdom can be more effective than weapons. But returning to the concept of vanity, which is Solomon's end at this point in time, all sorts of good things can be undone by one sinner. And thus he says, all is vanity. Now, this has been a depressing lesson for me to prepare and to study and try to figure where we're going. But I wanted to put it in, and thus we, one of the reasons to do chapter 9 today. Our last lesson will be from chapter 12 of Ecclesiastes, where Solomon seems to recognize that there is more to God than his fatalism has been expressing to us. So I invite you to be back with us as we study from chapter 12 of Ecclesiastes in our last lesson for the month of August. Thank you for being with us. Don't ever forget that Jesus came, and Solomon, before Jesus, did in all of his wisdom, did not have what we have, the knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Savior, God's Son, who came to provide grace to us all, that whoever believe in him will not just go away because of death, but we will have eternity in God's presence, in Jesus' presence, for all who know him. Thank you for being with us this morning. Good day.